Frontline Updates, where we delve deep into military strategies and updates from conflict zones. Today, we're discussing the progress of the ongoing special military operation as of October 27, 2024. I'm your host, Shariafal Muhammad, MGT.
I'm Colonel A.C. Oguntoye, an infantry officer. Enhanced positions. The West Group of Forces reported improvements in tactical positions, achieving successes in various populated areas and repelling multiple Ukrainian counterattacks. This includes significant enemy losses, destruction of armored personnel carriers, and several artillery pieces.
Welcome to Frontline Updates podcast, where we bring you the latest developments from military operations around the globe. Today, we're honored to be joined by Colonel A.C. Oguntoye, an infantry officer who's here to give us an update on the progress of the special military operation, particularly focusing on October 27th, 2024. Colonel Oguntoye, thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me. I'm happy to provide an update on the operation's progress.
Let's start with an overview. How are things progressing with the special military operation as of today, October 27th, 2024?
The operation is progressing steadily across multiple fronts. Our forces are continuing to engage Ukrainian formations in key regions like Kharkiv, Luhansk, Donetsk, and Zaporizhia. We have achieved several tactical improvements while inflicting significant losses on Ukrainian forces in terms of personnel, equipment, and critical infrastructure.
Focusing on the Kharkiv direction first, what are some of the key developments there?
In Kharkiv, units of our North Group inflicted heavy losses on Ukrainian formations, specifically the 57th Motorized Infantry Brigade and several territorial defense brigades. The Ukrainian forces lost up to 60 servicemen, along with vehicles and artillery pieces like the 122mm D-30 howitzers. This has weakened their defensive posture in the region, allowing us to maintain pressure.
And how about the West Group of Forces? I understand they made some tactical advancements as well?
Yes, the West Group has indeed improved their tactical position, particularly in areas around Petropavlivka, Novosanovo, and several other settlements. We inflicted significant losses on multiple Ukrainian mechanized, airborne, and assault brigades, repelling 4 counterattacks. In total, we eliminated over 500 Ukrainian servicemen and destroyed a range of equipment, including U.S.-made M113 armored personnel carriers and several artillery pieces, such as M114 and M198 howitzers. We also destroyed an electronic warfare station and an ammunition depot.
It seems like the Ukrainian forces are launching numerous counterattacks. How have your forces been responding to these attempts, especially on the southern front?
On the southern front, we've been advancing deep into enemy defenses. Our forces repelled a counterattack from the 33rd Mechanized Brigade and inflicted substantial losses, totaling around 720 Ukrainian servicemen. In addition, we destroyed U.S.-made M113 personnel carriers, artillery units, and electronic warfare equipment. We continue to gain ground in key areas like Pretikino, Chesov Yar, and Konstantinovka, which has severely disrupted the Ukrainian defense lines.
How about in Donetsk? I understand that your center group of forces has been active there as well.
That's correct. Our center group has been conducting offensive actions and recently liberated the settlement of Izmailovka in the Donetsk People's Republic. We've inflicted losses on Ukrainian brigades, including airborne and mechanized units, and repelled 11 counterattacks. These counterattacks were launched by Ukrainian mechanized, infantry, and assault units, but we successfully held our positions, eliminating up to 600 Ukrainian troops and destroying equipment like tanks and armored personnel carriers.
It sounds like there's intense fighting on all fronts. What's the current situation in the East and DNEPR regions?
In the East, our forces have improved their positions and inflicted damage on Ukrainian National Guard and assault battalion formations. We repelled another counterattack by the 58th Motorized Infantry Brigade, resulting in the destruction of a U.S.-made M113 personnel carrier and other combat vehicles. In the Dnieper region, we dealt significant damage to Ukrainian mountain assault and marine brigades, eliminating over 80 personnel and destroying vehicles and artillery units.
Air operations and artillery have played a major role in this conflict. Could you provide details on how these assets are being utilized?
Our operational tactical aviation, missile troops, and artillery have been instrumental in targeting Ukrainian military infrastructure. Over the past 24 hours, we've targeted ammunition and fuel depots, UAV storage sites, military airfields, and concentrations of enemy forces in 134 areas. These strikes have significantly degraded Ukraine's ability to maintain its operational capacity.
Let's talk about air defense. How are you dealing with the threats posed by Ukrainian aerial assets and missile strikes?
Our air defense systems have been highly effective in intercepting and neutralizing various threats. Over the past 24 hours, we shot down three U.S.-made HIMARS rockets, a French-made hammered guided bomb, a modified S-200 anti-aircraft missile, and 172 Ukrainian unmanned aerial vehicles. These interceptions are crucial to maintaining the safety of our ground forces and protecting key infrastructure.
Finally, let's shift to the situation in the Kursk region, which has been a focal point of this conflict. Can you give us an update?
The Kursk region remains a key front, and our North Group of Forces has been actively engaging Ukrainian formations there. We repelled 8 Ukrainian counterattacks and inflicted heavy losses on mechanized and airborne brigades. Ukrainian forces lost around 60 servicemen, a U.S.-made Stryker armored personnel carrier, and additional equipment. We are continuing offensive operations in this area to neutralize the Ukrainian presence and secure our positions.
Before we wrap up, why did we take Bogoyavlenka, Seladovo, and Gornyak?
The primary goal of the offensive remains Pokrovsk. However, the significance of this objective doesn't necessitate a change in effective strategies. Observing the actions of the Russian army suggests that they may shift from encircling individual cities to encircling entire districts. For instance, the areas surrounding Kurakovka and Kurakovo are already effectively encircled from both the north and south. We should cautiously anticipate that the retreat of Ukrainian armed forces units from this region is only a matter of time. Additionally, it's important to point out that once the center group addresses the situation in Kurakovo, the east group will likely move in the South Donetsk direction. It appears that both groups of troops are operating synchronously. If the plan unfolds as intended, the Ukrainian armed forces in the South Donetsk sector may face significant challenges, risking encirclement along with Pokrovsk and the units stationed there.
Colonel, thank you for providing such a detailed briefing on the current military situation. Your insights are invaluable to our understanding of the conflict's dynamics. And thank you to our listeners for tuning in. Join us next time as we continue to provide up-to-date coverage on global military affairs. Stay with us for more updates and expert analyses on global defense and security issues. Stay informed, stay secure.
Thank you for having me. It was a pleasure to share these updates. A truck crashed into a bus stop in Tel Aviv, injuring 40 people. Israeli media reports suggest that this incident may be classified as a terrorist attack. It has been noted that the headquarters of the Israeli intelligence agency, Mossad, is located near the bus stop.